Hello everybody, my name is Walter and today I want to show you my paintbrush data pack which I created recently. In this tutorial I will show you three things. First, how to install the data pack, then how to use it, and finally I will give you a detailed explanation of how it works and how you can customize it. And with that, let's start. So the first step is actually downloading the data pack itself, which is a zip file, and the link for that can be found in the description of this video. The next step is copying that zip file either as is or unpacking it into the corresponding subfolder of your world save folder. For that, all you have to do is simply go to the select world menu, then select the world where you want to enter it, then go on edit, and then click on open world folder, and that will open the world save folder, and in there you will find a subfolder called datapack, and in that subfolder you will simply copy the datapack itself. And that's already the entire installation process done, which brings us to the second part, the actual use of the data pack. Now, after installing the data pack, the next step is, of course, opening the world and then getting a brush. For that, all you have to do is open the chat console, enter the trigger command followed by brush menu, which you should be able to select at this point. Then you press enter and then you have the brush menu which opens, and at the moment you just have two options, get a brush and a cleanup option. The cleanup option, by the way, should be selected before you actually delete the data pack from the world save folder, and that basically just removes two objectives I created which the data pack itself use. Anyway, now let's give us a brush. Simply click on this, and now as you can see I have a brush, or in actually a carrot on a stick in my inventory, as you can see here. And as you can see, it's also at the moment selected for white wool. What this means will become obvious in a moment. And the next step we need to do is to actually put this in our offhand. So this data pack only works if the brush is in your offhand. And from here on, it's pretty easy to use. All you have to do is right click and then the block you're clicking on, or which is directly in front of you, will be selected. You can also hold down the right click button and just select and change the blocks. If you want to select a different color, you can also do that. All you need to do is go back, and as you can see here, the menu has gotten bigger, so now you can get a new brush, of course, the cleanup option is still there, but you can also change what kind of block you want to substitute with. So let's say we don't want any white wool. Now we want some black wool. And if you look into your inventory, now you can see here black wool is selected. And as you can see, now you can place black wool down. So that's basically how this thing here works. Now, one more thing to mention here is that there are actually two lists within the data pack that are rather important for its behavior. The first list is a list of swappable blocks. So at the moment you can only swap out iron, gold and obsidian blocks, and wool blocks of any kind of color. As you can see here, I can interact with the iron block in this case and exchange it with wool, but nothing is done to a stone block here. The second list is a list of ignored blocks, so if I click on any of those blocks, they will not interact with the data pack, and I will essentially click on the block behind them. So, for example here, I can't interact through the stone block here, but I can interact through the hopper here. So just one thing to keep in mind here. And as you can see, it's mostly redstone circuitry, which I mark down as ignored blocks. Additionally, we have the slabs, stairs, walls and glass. And, which you can see here of course, is air, which is the most important one of those. Otherwise the whole thing here wouldn't work properly. Anyway, that's pretty much all you need to know if you want to use this. And with that, we get to the last part of this tutorial, which is a detailed explanation of how this data pack works and how you can customize it. So anyway, within your save folder, as you can see in the data pack subfolder, we have the data pack. In this case, it's not zipped, but just a subfolder of that. And in here, in the data subfolder, we find the Minecraft and the brush folder. The Minecraft is not that interesting, but this brush is where the magic happens. So here in here we have the tags and blocks, And those are the two lists for the ignored blocks and the swappable blocks. You will see them later on. And then we have the subfolder functions. In here we have where the magic happens directly, and the menu options is basically just the interactive chat menu and what happens when you click on the options. Anyway, that's the folder structure. Now let's go into the various functions. The first function that is called when the world is opened or when the data pack is loaded in is the init function. And in here we simply create two objectives. The first objective is called brush clicked and is basically automatically increased by one every time a player uses a carrot on a stick. This is basically what's behind this one here. And the second one is an objective called brush menu, which is of the type trigger, which allows you to, under certain circumstances, use the trigger command on it and automatically increase it to one by simply using that command, as you saw earlier. And with that, let's get to the main function. This function is called 20 times a second and is basically the initial point for all of the magic happening. In here, the first step that happens is it looks for any player that has just clicked with a brush or with a carrot on a stick. So, as I already mentioned, this is automatically increased every time a carrot on a stick is used. So it's looking for such players. Then it also looks if the player has in his inventory, in the offhand, a carrot on a stick that has the custom name Magic Brush. And if that is also the case, then it calls the function triggered brush, which we will see in a moment, and which is basically where all of the ray tracing and the swapping happens. The next point is it looks for any player that triggered the menu. So anytime you use the trigger brush menu command, you increase your own brush menu objective. And if that is the case, then it calls the menu for you. Then the next step is it does reset the brush clicked menu for you. And it also resets the brush menu. So it's just a reset of those values here. And after that, it enables the brush menu. So this is necessary, otherwise you wouldn't be able to use the trigger command. Now let's go to the triggered brush function, which again is called if a player has clicked or used a magic brush. In here, several things happen. First, we summon in an armor stand with a tag called brush ray tracer, which is also not affected by gravity. Then we are teleporting that armor stand to the player. That means that now the armor stand has the same orientation as the player. Next, we are setting a value within the armor stand for the objective brush menu. This later on tells the armor stand what block we want to place when we find a swappable block. The default value is 1. Any other value can be also set. And what basically happens here is that in the magic brush we have a custom tag called block cell with a value behind it. And what we are doing here is essentially we are looking in our offhand slot within the magic brush for a specific value of this tag, and then we are just writing the corresponding number into the brush menu objective of the armor stand. So just a simple bridging of that value into that objective. And that's basically telling the armor stand what we want to place later on. Then we are writing another objective into the armor stand. Here I'm also reusing an already existing objective. So brush clicked is 0. This is used as a counter to make sure that the armor stand stops at a certain point later on. Next, we are teleporting the armor stand to the same heat as the eyes of the player. This is important to make sure that even if the player is sneaking, we are working on the block directly in front of us. Then we are using the ray tracing. So this is a function that is called by the armor stand itself. And finally, after that has been done, we are removing the armor stand again. So that's what's happening when the brush is triggered. Now let's get to the ray tracing itself. So now the ray tracing is a rather simple command actually. So the first step it does is actually teleporting the armor stand 10 centimeters forward, or 1/10 of a block forward. By the way, from this point on, the itself doesn't mean the player, but the ray tracing or the armor stand itself. So what it does is it teleports 10 centimeters into whatever direction the armor stand is facing. So if we are facing straight down, then we are going straight down. If you're facing west, it's going straight west, and so on. The next step is we are increasing our counter by one. Then we are looking if the block we are at the moment is a swappable block, and if that is the case, we are calling the replace block function, which basically does what the name implies. And then we are checking if the current block is one of the blocks to be ignored. If that is the case, we are checking that we are not within a piston that is retracted. Then we are doing the same for a sticky piston. So that means that if we are finding an extended piston, this one gets ignored. Then we are checking if our score we just increased is 55 or lower. And if all of that is the case, then we recall this retracing function. So that means that we will call this function 55 times until the counter is too great, which means that we are going essentially 5.5 meters away from the player. And at that point, at the latest, we stop with the ray tracing and then go back to the triggered brush and then remove the ray tracer again. So that's basically how the ray tracing here works. Now let's go and look into this replace block. This is also a rather simple function. Here we are looking into the brush menu value, which we wrote inside of the triggered brush function here, and which tells us again what kind of block we want to place. So basically, just depending on what number we find here, we are placing a certain type of block. So for example, wool or obsidian. And after that has been done, we are increasing the score board value of brush clicked to a very high number, which means that effectively the ray tracing stops at this point here. So that means once we found a swappable block, we will go no further, even if the swappable blocks or the blocks we have swapped in are actually in the ignore blocks list. And with that, the ray tracing is done. Now let's go back to the main function, since here we are also calling the brush menu function if the corresponding trigger was set. And what happens here is just a couple of telraw commands. So first we have a simple text. Then we have a JSON text, which has a command which is run when we click on it, which simply calls a function within the menu options submenu or subfolder called give new brush, which is a simple give command, which gives us the corresponding magic brush and then recalls the brush menu just to make sure that we have the updated menu in our chatbox. Then following that, we have pretty much the same, just the cleanup command this time with the corresponding text and the corresponding cleanup command, our function, which is a simple removal of the two scoreboard objectives we created in our init function here. Then, after that tellraw command, if the current player has a magic brush in his inventory, we also call the selection menu. So this is the additional part of the menu that also appeared once we had a brush in our inventory. And in here, we also have just a couple of tellraw commands, which are just, again, what is written in the chat console, and then the command which is run behind it. So this is just a simple command, and if we go in here, this is using the replace item command, which looks into the player. First it checks if the player has a magic brush in his offhand, and then it replaces whatever he has in his offhand, which is of course the brush, with a new brush that has the new value for the block selected. So basically we are overwriting this block selected tag and also this lower text. So this is the text that tells us what color is selected. And then once more we are recalling the brush menu. And that's more or less all of the functions. Now the last two parts are the swappable and the ignore blocks. The swappable blocks is a simple list of the blocks you can swap out with the brush. So at the moment, iron, gold, obsidian, and wool in any kind of color. And the ignore blocks is blocks we can actually ray trace through. So blocks that don't stop the ray tracing. Most important of that is, of course, air. And then as you can see, I've added also glass, many, many redstone components, and several other things. So this is more or less the entire list. If you are interested in that, you can of course add more to this list. You can also add more to this list here to change the behavior of the data pack. And if you want to introduce more blocks you want to put instead of the blocks you swap, then you will have to add them in here for the block selected. You will have to put them in the replace block function. Then you will have to add a corresponding menu function. You will have to modify the selection menu. And finally, you might have to actually modify those lists here. And that's pretty much all of the explanation done. And with that, we have finally reached the end of this tutorial about my paintbrush data pack. I hope you enjoyed this little tutorial, and well, see ya!